Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we're going to be talking about the recent ceasefire agreement in Syria. And for that we have Prabir Purkaistha, Editor-in-Chief NewsClick. So Prabir, if you could tell us what is different about this ceasefire agreement than the previous one, seeing how they failed the previous ceasefires.
Well, you're right. The previous ceasefire agreement generally ended up not being successful. They held for some time, maybe a few days, sometimes a couple of weeks, but really didn't hold. And what is different this time is an important question. I think the first and the most important part is it's been worked out without the United States. This is really an agreement which is being done between Turkey, Russia, Syria, and Iran. In fact, Syria was not directly a participant in the discussion. It was really Iran, Russia, and Turkey which negotiated the ceasefire with, of course, both the sides. Clearly, Al-Qaeda affiliate, what is used to be Jabhat al-Nusra, now Fateh al-Sham, is not a party to the agreement, neither is ISIS. This is what the Russians, as well as the Iranians and the Syrians have said. Interestingly enough, the rebels have said, no, they should be a part of this agreement. So there is already a point of discord, whether this agreement covers the rebels as well as Al-Qaeda forces and what are being called rebels, and whether it does not. So that's an open question. So there is a possibility this will not hold. But the important part, I think, is that this time it's Turkey which has really changed sides. Earlier, it used to be with the Western powers. It used to be Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Gulf Emirates, all these Gulf states. So there is a change of the part of the correlation of forces outside Syria, as it were, which has directly influenced Syria, because this is, in some sense, a proxy war. It's a war which has been done against Bashar al-Assad's government by a whole range of forces, including NATO powers, as well as the local Gulf monarchies, which have been behind this, with, of course, also Israel support. So the fact that Turkey has changed is, I think, the significant part of it. Will the ceasefire hold? Open question.
So what are the areas, do you think, where the ceasefire will hold and where all it can fail?
Well, I think there are four distinct areas we can talk about in terms of, shall we say, the larger strategic moves in Syria. One is near Damascus, the southwest part of Syria. In that part, it does appear that the major players are the so-called Free Syrian Army, rebels, and Al-Qaeda is not as strong as it is in other areas, or ISIS is not as strong as it is in other areas. So this is an area which looks like could be a place where the ceasefire would hold, and the rebels would actually lay down their arms, come into some kind of strategic understanding with the Syrian government, and would slowly be, in that sense, assimilated in some way into a new setup. So there is a possibility in these areas that you will actually have the ceasefire hold. Now, there are pockets where ISIS is there, Al-Qaeda is there, and so on. And there are pockets which have been independent rebel areas, which have been very close to Saudis and so on. But at the same time, given the turn of events after Aleppo's fall, I think they are all beginning to recognize that Assad government is here to stay. It's not going to fall. And if it doesn't fall, then they can go on fighting, but they're not really going to achieve anything. And at the same time, with the Syrian Air Force, the Russian Air Force having control over the skies, increasingly the turn of the battle is turning against them. So I think that's an area where you're likely to see some resolution. Eastern Syria, where the ISIS is in control, which is largely desert, this is really going to see how the Russians, the Americans play this among themselves, because the Americans have now backed the Iraqis in Mosul, which is their joining area, to the eastern part of Syria. So what happens in Mosul, what happens in Raqqa, what happens in Deir ez-Zor are in some sense linked, because this is where the ISIS really holds sway. And this is an area where it's continuing to shrink, but ISIS still is powerful over there. The other part of it, and I'll come to the most difficult part later, other part of it is northern Aleppo, or what's the whole northern belt of Syria, where the Kurds and the Turks, as well as the Syrian government and the ISIS, are in battle in different ways. And in this, the Turkish interest at the moment seems to be north of Aleppo, or northern part of Aleppo, the governorate, That part of it, if we look, it does appear that Turkey and Russia have reached some agreement among themselves that this part, Turkey would and its rebel allies would hold sway, and ISIS will be eliminated from that part. At the same time, the Turks, the Kurdish northern part, which if that part falls also to the Kurds, become one contiguous area, which is what they call the Rojava state or Rojava, some entity called Rojava, that will not take place because the Kurds then would not have a contiguous area. So this is something which is between the Kurds, Turks and the Syrian government that is being worked out, it seems, by which the status quo would see Turks play some role in northern Aleppo. The last and the most difficult is where the so-called rebel forces are mixed with Al-Qaeda very closely. It has a Harar al-Sham, which is really what we call Al-Qaeda light. And that's again once a Sharia-based state, very close to what the ideology of the Al-Qaeda really is. So Harar al-Sham and Al-Qaeda are the leading military force in Idlib, which is the last bastion of the rebels, so to say, in northwest of Aleppo. And that area is where we are likely to see the so-called true ceasefire really break down. No ceasefire over eastern Syria, where the ISIS is there. Everybody agrees that there is no ceasefire there. Northern Aleppo, yes, a ceasefire which can hold. Southwestern Syria, where ceasefire can hold. It includes Homs, Hama, townships and so on, where slowly the rebels would lay down arms and get assimilated. And Idlib is the place where it appears the ceasefire will not hold. And we are likely to see further war continuing over there.
So you mentioned that this is the first time that US has not been part of the ceasefire agreement. So what do you think the America's role would be in the future of Syria?
Now, that's a very important question. I think that's the biggest change that we are seeing right now. That till now, the Western powers, including the United States, which is, of course, the leader of the Western bloc, has called the shots. Whether it's a UN negotiations, the negotiations that were carried out earlier in Saudi Arabia, with all the parties, it's really the West which has called the shots and has been and tried at least to put everybody together as it appeared, in which one of the major demands used to be Bashar al-Assad has to go. That's how most of these negotiations really did not bear any fruit. The first time that you see the United States has virtually lost its place in the negotiations for ceasefire. And so it does seem that it is increasingly becoming irrelevant in the civil war that is going on or the proxy war in Syria. Now, that is a significant change from whatever we have seen in the past. I don't think it's possible for the United States to be or the West to be completely squeezed out of Syria for the simple fact that they are players, they are supplying arms, they have supplied in the past what are called man pads. They have supplied anti-tank missiles, which are in the control of ISIS. Large part of it has fallen to ISIS or to Al-Qaeda forces. So they will still remain spoilers. Their ability to spoil anything that happens in the region is there, including, as we knew, we know now earlier, that ISIS itself was partly the product of the American policies, either of benign neglect, letting it happen, or of active connivance. So this has been the US policies in the region, to keep it fragmented, break it up, not have a continuous so-called Shia axis, which is Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Hezbollah. So all of these policies now would see that the United States is not a part of what is going to happen in Syria in terms of an active direction, but nevertheless could be a spoiler. And if it acts as a spoiler, then it can keep the civil war or the current war that is going on also for some time by either not coming out against ISIS beyond the Iraq border or, for instance, supplying still through Saudi Arabia, through Qatar, other Gulf states, arms to Al-Qaeda forces and its allies in the name of supporting the so-called Free Syrian Army. So the US role could also be that of not wanting any peace in Syria, not even talking about it, but instead wanting the war to continue. Looking at Israel's interests, looking at US geostrategic interests, that could be a possible line that it could take up. Under Trump, will this line change? We really don't know. This has been Obama's position. This has been, in some sense, the continuity of the West's position in West Asia, break up the countries, particularly those that pose a threat to Israel. So we really have to see whether Trump would change policies or he would be unpredictable to the extent of either wanting peace or more war. We really don't know. The last point is, I think it also depends a lot on Turkey-US relationships. Now, it's also clear that the coup attempt against Erdogan was seen by Erdogan and the AKP in Turkey as a threat posed by the United States to the kind of policies they were building. So they have turned against NATO for policies they have really broken in the US right now in foreign policy terms. And they have therefore tried to work out some modus vivendi with Russia, with Saudi Arabia, with Syria. Syrian government, which until very recently and even after their so-called rapprochement with Russia, they have been talking about that Bashar al-Assad should go. So they haven't really changed their fundamental position, but it does appear that they have broken at least significantly on the question of Syria with the United States and with NATO. Will that also last? Will they also come back again to the NATO fold? Will the break with Russia again? That's a big imponderable. Because at the moment, Erdogan is a bit like Trump. We do not know which way he's going to swing.
Thank you, Praveer, for talking with us on this topic. And we will have more interviews as it proceeds. This is all the time we have on NewsClick. Thank you for joining us.
The concept that humanity is teetering on the edge of a third world war is no longer the domain of the lunatic fringe. Those of you who have been paying attention know that in reality, the war is already underway. In this video, we are going to examine the profiles of the key players and the alliances they've formed, expose their motives, and present evidence of crimes that they've already committed. Russia, China, and Iran have all explicitly sided with the Syrian government. Russia is providing air support, advanced anti-aircraft missile systems, heavy weapons and training. Iran, for its part, has troops on the ground. For the time being, China is more preoccupied with the ongoing tensions in the South China Sea, and has not flexed its missiles in Syria, as of yet. However, they should always be considered a wild card variable. The current Iraqi government is also a wild card. In 2015, they began to indicate where their loyalties lay in several meaningful ways. For example, they told the US government that new ground operations were not welcome, while at the same time announcing that they intend to look to Russia for military assistance. The list of countries pushing for regime change in Syria is a bit longer. The United States, France, England, Germany, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Qatar, Turkey, and Israel. If seeing these characters in bed together strikes you as strange, looking at their motives will clarify things considerably. There isn't just one motive for this bloodbath. Rather, there is a matrix of motives which intersect in some rather odd places. Of course, money had to play a role. In 2009, Qatar put forth a proposal to build a natural gas pipeline which would have passed through Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Syria, to Turkey and into Europe. The president of Syria, however, rejected this proposal. Instead, in 2011 he forged a pact with Iraq and Iran to run a pipeline eastward, cutting Qatar and Saudi Arabia out of the loop completely. It was around this time that jihadists began flooding into the region intent on ousting Assad. The West presented these groups as freedom fighters. The vast majority of these militants, ISIS included, are Sunni jihadists, which is significant, because Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Turkey and Jordan are all Sunni as well, and Saudi Arabia in particular has a long history of spreading their preferred strain of Sunni extremism, Wahhabism, by investing heavily in building mosques, madrasas, schools, and Sunni cultural centers across the Muslim world. Now they have ISIS pushing it by the barrel of a gun. ISIS adheres to the Wahhabi form of Sunni Islam. ISIS is not merely some dark aberration. Wahhabism as a philosophy calls for its adherents to take the reins of power by force, and to impose Sharia law. Wahhabism also encourages its followers to persecute Shia Muslims, which they consider apostates. And of course, apostasy is punishable by death. Iran is Shia. The current government in Iraq is Shia, and has strong ties with Iran. The pipeline deal which Assad accepted would strengthen this Shia bloc, and its regional influence. The Sunnis don't like this. In fact, they've even coined a term to describe it, the Shia Crescent. Israel also doesn't like this Shia Crescent, at all, and they have decided to work with the Sunnis to form a parallel bloc to counterbalance Iran's influence. That's why Israel has launched numerous airstrikes against the Syrian government over the years, and has provided medical care, logistical support and safe passage to known jihadists. In 2013, Israel's ambassador to the US, Michael Oren, told the Jerusalem Post that the initial message about the Syrian issue was that we always wanted Bashar Assad to go. We always preferred the bad guys who were not backed by Iran, compared to the bad guys who were backed by Iran. He said, this was the case. He said, even if the other bad guys were affiliated to Al-Qaeda, let that sink in for a moment. Now at this point, if you were to ask any of these governments directly where they are arming and funding jihadists in Syria, they would claim that they are only supporting the moderate rebels, specifically the FSA. However, FSA commanders have gone on record to say that they cooperate with and conduct joint operations with al-Nusra, Al-Qaeda's official branch in Syria, and ISIS and al-Nusra have officially formed alliances. And it is well established that the FSA command has been dominated by Islamic extremists for years. Furthermore, a think tank that was founded by Tony Blair released a report in 2015 which concluded that it was pointless to attempt to make a distinction between moderate rebels and jihadists, since the majority of these groups share ISIS's core belief system and would impose Sharia law if they came into power. In this context, the support being given to these groups can only be interpreted as material support for terrorism, which is a crime. Now the US government has been arming, funding and training these extremists both covertly and overtly since 2011. However, this support would have been impossible without the assistance of the regional members of the anti-Assad axis. For years, Jordan has allowed the CIA to run training camps for militant groups and has granted those militants safe passage into Syria. Qatar has also provided training grounds. In 2014, PBS visited one of these training camps and interviewed some of the trainees. One of the fighters told the reporters that they were being trained how to finish off soldiers still alive after an ambush. Finishing off wounded soldiers is a clear violation of the Geneva Conventions. It's a war crime. This is a hallmark of a terrorist organization, not moderate freedom fighters. Turkey has been the primary route for material and personnel headed in and out of jihadist territory for many years. A blatant example of this was 400 tons of weapons that were looted from Gaddafi's armories, shipped to Turkey and then moved into Syria in 2012. At this stage, they weren't even trying to hide it, even though it was already clear that jihadists were receiving the lion's share of the weapons. Jordan, Saudi Arabia and Qatar also have assisted in the transfer of heavy weapons directly to al-Nusra by flying hundreds of cargo flights into Syria. And then there's the infamous Toyota trucks which ISIS drives. US counter-terrorism officials made a show of investigating where they were getting these trucks, but it would have been much simpler if they had just called up the US State Department. According to the Prive, the US State Department has been supplying Toyota Heliuxes, the exact model being used by ISIS, to the FSA for years. Specific equipment like the Toyota Heliuxes are what we refer to as force enablers for the moderate opposition forces on the ground. He adds, Shahbander says the US supplied pickups will be delivering troops and supplies into battle. Some of the fleet will even become battlefield weapons. You can absolutely expect for many of those trucks to be mounted with crew serve machine guns or other type of equipment, military equipment, that the opposition forces have access to. I mean, that's one of the reasons why the Toyota Hilux is such an important force multiplier, because it could be used both for humanitarian purposes and for operational purposes as well. Knowing the real chain of alliances between these groups, it makes perfect sense that ISIS would end up behind the wheel. And let's not forget about the oil. At this stage, ISIS has reached a point where it no longer needs direct sponsorship. The organization earns an estimated $1 million to $2 million a day through oil sales. The US was aware of this but did nothing to stop it. They didn't even condemn the country which was facilitating the sale of this oil. Russia, on the other hand, began targeting oil convoys headed into Turkey in November of 2015. Shortly thereafter, Turkey shot down a Russian Su-24 that supposedly violated Turkish airspace for 17 seconds. In response, Russia released satellite evidence that they claimed shows how Turkey is smuggling oil from ISIS. The US government dismissed this evidence, but didn't counter it with any evidence of their own. So where is the oil going? We're supposed to just put that little detail out of our minds. They knew, but they did nothing. Why? Right. And I suppose we didn't call out Turkey for buying the oil because we didn't want to hurt Erdogan's feelings. Clearly it is not in the interest of the anti-Assad axis to eliminate ISIS. The United States and France are keen to make a show of airstrikes and special forces. But what they really want is the ability to operate in Syria militarily. This is the only way they'll have any chance of influencing the outcome. Trouble is, Russia is dug in. Unlike the United States and France, they have permission to operate in the country, and this has allowed them to set up bases and a strong anti-aircraft defense grid which at any point could be used to enforce a no-fly zone. Washington is in a weak position. It can't really win from this angle, so they'll have to find a way to put Russia off balance and retake the momentum. It's important to remember the real stakes in this conflict. The West is in a state of decline. Their influence is waning. If the US and their allies fail to remove Assad from power, what they will be faced with is more than just a strong Shia crescent. If they fail, they risk being etched out of the entire region and replaced by Russia. This would give Russia an enormous amount of leverage in global energy markets. And this, of course, has serious implications for the petrodollar. For Washington, this is an unacceptable outcome. So expect the unexpected.
Russia's hacked into a lot of things. China's hacked into a lot of things. Russia even hacked into the Democratic National Committee. Maybe even some state election systems. So we've got to step up our game. Make sure we are well defended and able to take the fight to those who go after us. As president, I will make it clear that the United States will treat cyber attacks just like any other attack. We will be ready with serious political, economic, and military responses.
И люди не чувствуют опасности. Вот меня что беспокоит. Ну как вот как мы не можем понять? Мы тащим мир вообще в совершенно новое измерение. Вот в чем проблема. Делают вид, что как будто ничего не происходит. Но я не знаю даже, как достучаться.
We're flying over Estonia now, just over to the east, to the right, is Russia.
We need to be ready. We should not be afraid.
Ready for?
Ready for opportunistic behavior of Putin's Russia.
These US Marines are about to perform their first ever amphibious landing from the Black Sea onto the Ukrainian coastline.
15 amphibious assault vehicles packed with both US and Ukrainian Marines secured a beach south of the port city of Odessa, before heading inland as part of the annual multinational naval exercise Sea Breeze.
This year the US Navy deployed two ships, the USS Ross, a guided missile destroyer, and this ship, the USS Whitby Island, which acted as a launching pad for the amphibious operation.
The Black Sea is bounded by six countries linking southeastern Europe and western Asia. Since the Russian annexation of Crimea in 2014, the security situation here has been very tense at times.
Ukrainian President Petro Poroshenko has instructed all military units near Crimea and in the eastern Donbas region to be at their highest level of combat readiness.
we need to be ready. We should not be afraid.
Ready for?
Ready for opportunistic behavior of Putin's Russia.